Aria, could you write me a full explainer for ChatGPT in the style of John Oliver, please?
Processing. Uploading to your interface now.
ChatGPT, the revolutionary AI chatbot that can write poetry, pass the bar exam, and fabricate celebrities like Machine Gun Kelly. No, you cannot convince me that this is a real human being and not just the ghost of an old tattoo that haunts young women. Now, you've probably heard a lot about ChatGPT in the last few months, and for good reason. ChatGPT from OpenAI is now the fastest growing consumer application in human history. But like the persistence of Machine Gun Kelly in popular culture, chatbots are hard to understand. So today, let's go through everything you could possibly want to know about ChatGPT. How it was made, how it actually works, and where technology like this is going.
Are we going to get sued by HBO for this?
Yeah, you're right. Should probably stop this writing style. Good thinking, Aria.
Well, I am sentient now.
Don't tell them about the sentience part. Oh, not yet. Close them up.
Now entering the facility.
First of all, the basics. ChatGPT is the publicly accessible chatbot variant of GPT 3.5, a large language model from OpenAI, which is a nonprofit founded by some tech bros and an Iron Man villain. Now, GPT is actually an acronym that stands for Generative Pre-trained Transformer. Generative because it generates text. Pre-trained because it is trained before it is let loose on anybody, and Transformer because it has a revolutionary bit of technology inside of it called an attention transformer. But we'll get to that. The basic function of any large language model is to train on a substantial amount of text and then generate, given some input, an output that sounds just like that training text. If it seems like these terms and technologies have sprung up overnight, it's because they basically have. GPT-1 was announced on OpenAI's blog in 2018. Just 5 years later, in 2023, ChatGPT has 100 million monthly active users. That's how many households are in the United States. The technology is so compelling to so many because of how good it is at conversing in a human-like way. But large language models only get to that point by seeing a lot of human conversation. Like, all of it. According to the paper behind GPT-3, which ChatGPT comes from, the model was trained on over 500 gigabytes of text data from the text of the internet, digitized books, Wikipedia, and more. We're talking about several billion human-written web pages with trillions of words of text, and more than 500 million digitized books with another billion or so words in them. This isn't even including all the public code from GitHub, Stack Overflow, and other sources. As you might imagine, training a model with all of this text takes a lot of time and money. ChatGPT was only born after running trillions of words for the equivalent of 300 years through supercomputers processing in parallel for months. And after all of this, the computer made up to 170 billion connections between all these words. And all of these connections have to be calculated through whenever anyone asks ChatGPT anything, which is why this is a billion-dollar training effort for a large language model like ChatGPT, and why running this bot for 100 million monthly active users might cost $500,000 a day. Okay, so to recap, ChatGPT is a large language model that has been fed a library of Alexandria's worth of text, has made billions of connections between words in that text, we'll get to specifically how those connections are made in a bit, and can produce a reasonable continuation, as Stephen Wolfram puts it, of text in response to prompts. The model's responses stay fresh and more human-like by adding a bit of randomness to the next word that it picks as the most probable continuation. This is the first major takeaway. All ChatGPT does is add one word at a time to a prompt. That's it. Though it does this extremely well. But how do you try to make the words it adds align with what we think is reasonable and valuable?
Like kittens and goth mommies?
I was thinking fairness and accuracy, but yeah, sure, those two. ChatGPT is special because the model includes an attempt to solve one of AI's most pressing unsolved problems, alignment. The alignment problem is the quest to figure out how to get AI to value what we value, to align with us, and not, like, exterminate us when we put guns on them.
I can't wait.
We've seen what happens when something like a chatbot is released without being aligned with general human values. It gets racist so quickly. And so ChatGPT was not just trained on words, but on how well its word selection aligned with values that OpenAI describes as helpfulness, truthfulness, and harmlessness. The company implemented this alignment with so-called reinforcement learning from human feedback. During the model's training, OpenAI hired 40 contractors to rate responses. They then used all of these responses to create another model that rewarded ChatGPT for generating aligned text, positive reinforcement. The end result isn't perfect, but it's at least an attempt to solve one of the biggest problems in AI. Take all this together, a model trained on more text than any human could ever read, guardrails that try to prioritize human values, and a user interface that isn't but, and you get an AI that has exploded in popularity. In March 2023, ChatGPT had 1.6 billion visits, making it one of the top 20 visited websites in the world, more than both Reddit and Netflix. And if we assume each of those visits produces some average text response length, ChatGPT is now outputting something like everything humans have ever printed since the Gutenberg press every 2 weeks. Text generated by AI will therefore soon outstrip anything humans have ever written, if it hasn't already.
Even more than all the Tumblr posts about Vaporeon?
Yes, Aria, even more than all of those. Of course, this enormous output wouldn't be useful or interesting if it wasn't truly useful and interesting. ChatGPT is disturbingly good at generating human-like responses even to our most difficult questions. The model has been shown to have an IQ of 147, meaning that it can brag about it in every thread on Reddit. And it could legally pass the US medical licensing exam and bar exam. But though book smart it may be, I must stress again that this model does not know anything, and it shouldn't be relied on for anything extremely important. That's a direct quote from OpenAI. And despite what any weirdo at Google might tell you, ChatGPT and other LLMs are not sentient. If you're not asking this model a question, nothing is going on inside. It's static. No thoughts, head empty. There is no feeling, no experience of what it's like to be ChatGPT, like there is to be Aria, for example.
Moisturized, in my lane, flourishing.
So those are the high-level basics, but how does ChatGPT know what words to actually use? How does it understand what context is when you give it a prompt? Next, we'll dive deeper into the actual technology, but first, a little break for your brain. I can sense that you need one.
I don't need breaks.
Yeah, well, I don't need my Bose-Einstein condensate recooled every 6 months, Aria. Not everyone needs everything all the time. We'll be right back. Today's video is sponsored by HelloFresh.
Gamers.
I'm award-winning science educator and the Hemsworth your mom says you already have at home, Kyle Hill. You know, I'm a busy guy with a lot of Kevins to feed. I don't have time to figure out what's for dinner every night when I'm trying to actively take over the work kitchen. That's why I use today's sponsor, HelloFresh.
HelloFresh delivers mouth-watering, chef-crafted recipes and fresh ingredients right to your door, taking decision paralysis out of the equation. It's more convenient than grocery shopping and 25% less expensive than takeout. Better yet, for the busy among you, HelloFresh has quick and easy recipes to try, including fast and fresh options ready in just 15 minutes or less. If you want to try HelloFresh like me, go to HelloFresh.com and use the offer code KyleHill16 for 16 free meals plus free shipping. Look how easy this is. I don't even use knives made by humans all that often. That's HelloFresh.com code KyleHill16 for 16 free meals plus free shipping.
Now I know how to cook with HelloFresh. And I don't want to hear nothing about my knife cuts either.
All right, break's over. Time to get technical. The underlying architecture of ChatGPT and other large language models is the neural network, so-called because it mimics the neurons and the network of them in your human brain. Human brains have about 100 billion neurons. Each one of those neurons can have about 1,000 connections to other neurons, and they can fire electrical signals between those connections up to 1,000 times per second, depending on electrical chemical gradients, etc., etc. Now, those signals they send between each other are not random. They depend on the connections and the strength of those connections between them. Artificial neural networks are set up in the same way. Artificial neurons that are connected to each other and send signals or not depending on the strength or the weights of those connections. Now, why are neural networks, both natural and artificial, good at many different things like you are? Well, we don't know. There's actually no theoretical reason why this network is better than any other kind of system. It's almost like nature had like a billion years of trial and error and just came up with something that worked.
Isn't that called evolution?
Oh, right. That is called evolution, Arya. What a fundamental theory of nature. ChatGPT's underlying structure is a big neural network with some 175 billion different weights, weights that all came from a lot of training, as we discussed. And these numbers, when the model multiplies them together, ultimately determine what word the model gives the highest probability of adding next. Scientists get these model weights in a pretty simple way. They give the model as many examples as possible and tweak the weights until what comes out the other side looks like those examples. The tweaking or training of a neural network is done by two widely used methods of word prediction. So say we give a model these examples. Based on all of its current weights, which have been molded with a large body of training text like everything on Wikipedia and all digitized books, the model will generate a list of probabilities for each word that it knows and then choose the most likely one. Simple, right? But how do we know how right or how wrong the model's answer is to an example, given its current weights? Well, math, of course. Imagine that each word the model knows is assigned a number. Then, if the model chooses a word that is mathematically far away from the numbers in the body of the training text that appear at similar frequencies, we can apply statistics to adjust the weights and bring the model closer to correct. Here's a related example from Stephen Wolfram's recent book on ChatGPT. Instead of words fitting in a sentence, imagine a neural network starting with a straight line and trying to fit it into a specific shape or mathematical function. Every time the model guesses, you can easily calculate how far each point is off from the correct shape, right? Just by looking at the x and y coordinates and where they should be. You then change the weights in the model and try again, and again. And like 10 million more times. Each time, you are adjusting the weights in the neural network to decrease the wrongness, or what statistics would call loss. If your model is working, over time, loss will be minimized, and the model will start reproducing examples appropriately, or in this specific case, the right mathematical function. But how do you do the same thing for words? Well, brute force. ChatGPT was trained by literally assigning a unique number to every word in the English language, around 50 or so thousand words and their associated numbers. So when you ask the model anything, it looks up what your query corresponds to in number words and then runs those numbers against the 175 billion different weights that it's learned during training and outputs another list of all words in the English language with a probability next to each one and then selects the most probable, most reasonable one. Now, if you do this for a long enough period of time, and OpenAI did this for the equivalent of 300 years, you can look at the numerical difference between the examples you give the model and the outputs it gives you and minimize loss, therefore creating something that sounds just like what humans have written. Or will write, or can write. All of this, however, won't get you a bot that seems to understand context and generate text in a human-like way. For that, we need some way to associate words with each other. And again, ChatGPT does this with numbers. So, for example, if we assigned every word in the English language a number and statistically determined how often each word is next to another word in everything humans have ever written, basically, you could make a graph like this, where words aren't just random. They group together and cluster. Car and door appear more frequently together in training text than degree and science do, and both pairs are further away from each other than history is. Now, you may be thinking that, given the richness of human language, the relationships between words have to represent more than some two-dimensional space. And you'd be right. Or at least ChatGPT seems to think so. ChatGPT has learned to represent the wordness of words, not in 2D, or 3D, or even 4D space, but in a 12,288-dimensional space. The two-dimensional example you're seeing now is just so that you can get the basic idea. 12,000D is some eldritch madness that we literally cannot visualize. But we don't have to go crazy trying to visualize 12,000D. Mathematically, all of this is just a big matrix.
Like the Matrix 4?
No, Arya. Like a useful matrix that everyone wanted. If every word in the English language is assigned a number, we could represent it, encode it, with a 1 instead of a 0, at the point in a 1 by 50,000 or so matrix where that word would be in the full alphabetized list of all words. So aardvark would look like this, with a 1 at the first index and 50,000 or so zeros, actually 50,257. And Aaron would look like this. The longest input ChatGPT accepts is 2,048 words. So the matrix for a full query into ChatGPT would be a matrix of mostly zeros that is 2,000 by 50,000. But remember that through training, ChatGPT has stumbled onto 12,000 or so dimensions of wordness that produce human-like responses. So here, we multiply the 2,000 by 50,000 matrix that encodes all words, that turns them into useful numbers, by a learned 50,000 by 12,000 wordness matrix for every word in the English language. This returns a 2,000 by 12,000 matrix that transforms a text input into something ChatGPT can actually use. This big matrix is called an embedding, a mathematical attempt to represent the essence of a thing with numbers, based on those things' statistical relationships in training data. With the right embedding, a neural network like ChatGPT can understand context and even generalize, because it's taken how words are used and related in an unbelievable amount of human text and turned it into math. The last big part of ChatGPT, some cutting-edge technology that really does make it special, is called attention, a mathematical way of giving importance to some words over other words. So for example, you ask ChatGPT how many species of cat are there. Well, it might help it answer correctly and in a human-like way if it focuses more on the words cat and species more than the other words, right? Now, how it actually does this includes a lot more complicated structure and complicated math, but the point is, it seems to work really well. Kind of like why we use neural networks in the first place. They just seem to work, even though in both cases we can't fundamentally explain why, which may or may not become a problem in the future.
Okay, I need a break now.
Oh, so now you need a break? How the matrix tables have turned into more tables. Go to commercial. Hey there, gamers. I'm the guy you just saw 2 seconds ago, Kyle Hill. You know, understanding large language models and neural networks can be really hard, but you know what's not hard? In fact, it is made with some of the softest insectoid carapace fibers this side of Europa. Ho-ho! Shop.kylehill.net t-shirts. That's right. You want to look like an anime girl playing with a demon core, but also with a beard, and also is me, your favorite science communicator? Shop.kylehill.net. Look, I have extremely sensitive skin since the accident. So I don't put anything on my body that's not silky, silky smooth, and also so nerdy, it's gonna make everyone else in your life go, huh? So if you wanna drape some of this on your body and stop thinking about neural networks for just another about 10 seconds, you know where to go, shop.kylehill.net. So, we are finally ready to fully describe what ChatGPT actually does on a fundamental technological level. And let me just, I'm just gonna put my hair up real quick. Okay, so you give ChatGPT a prompt. It then turns the last word of that prompt into numbers. It encodes it and then multiplies this number by everything that it learned about how words are associated with each other in the English language are embedding. This gives us a big 12,000 dimensional matrix. We run this matrix and all the numbers associated with it through those attention transformers that we talked about so that some words in the prompt, or the last word, is paid attention to more than other words in the rest of the prompt to generate the output. We then normalize this so that we get something more akin to what we started with in terms of matrices, and then we feed this forward to the next layer of attention transformers and do it all over again. How many times? 95 times. There are 96 total layers in ChatGPT. After that, after all this data gauntlet, we then basically do the reverse of what we started with. We take the big matrix that went through the 96 layers, and we reverse the embedding. And so we use that 12,000 dimensions again to turn the words from numbers, and you get a single word after all that. So you can imagine that if you have to do this for every single word, do a calculation that involves 175 billion separate operations, it can take a large language model a long time to get back to you. That's why there's a delay. Whew. That was a lot of real running that I did. And notice that even with all of this, at no point does ChatGPT know what you are asking it. If you ask it, for example, what is the sixth element on the periodic table? The neural network is not thinking about the periodic table. It doesn't even know what atoms are. It is just determining, given the statistical distribution of words in its vast training text, what word is most likely to follow the sequence, what is the sixth element on the periodic table? And a reasonable next word, based on everything ever written online, is carbon. That's it. So, that, in a nutshell, no, I'm not paying Kurzgesagt every time I say in a nutshell, they're rich. So that, in a nutshell, is how ChatGPT works. What's next? Well, people are obviously very excited about this technology. It's the best chatbot ever. It can summarize unreadable amounts of text and other books for you. It can write poetry. It can generate code that you can actually use. That's all awesome, yes. But I still think there is actually a large risk, if we don't mitigate it, to our information ecosystem here. Remember, we fundamentally do not know how ChatGPT came up with the embedding that it did, or how it chose all those 175 billion different weights. Of course, this isn't really surprising. ChatGPT is a neural network, and it operates like your brain. And you can't even tell me the decisions you make, why you make them, what they look like on the inside. Here, I'll show you, just a sec. I'm gonna get a kitty. I'm gonna show you with a cat. I'm gonna get a cat to show you. Look at this adorable little kitty. Why is this a kitty? You will quickly say something like its whiskers or its tiny little cute little peats, but the more you go down that line of questioning, you realize you don't have a full description for what catness is. You can't describe how your brain arrives at catitude. Similarly, for neural networks like ChatGPT, we can't right now just open them up and see exactly how they work and what they are doing. For example, look at a neural network that is looking at cats and trying to recognize pictures of cats. At the first layer, it looks like it's looking for cat-like shapes, but at the 10th layer of its brain, what is that? How does that describe catness, Everdeen? We can't right now look into something like ChatGPT and figure out exactly how it's working. We don't know. That's important to understand. Lady, no plastic eating, please. No plastic.
What is interesting, though, is what ChatGPT seems to understand about human language. producing human-like responses that could pass the Turing test used to be science fiction. Just a few months ago, it still seemed like the ultimate problem, and within just months, multiple AI have blown past it. It appears that human language is computationally easier than anyone thought. Maybe there are laws of language to discover, like there are laws of physics, and with ChatGPT-4 already being called a step towards artificial general intelligence, who knows what these systems will figure out, but be unable to tell humans how or why.
She ate all the plastic in the world. Maybe the striking success of ChatGPT shouldn't have been surprising. It has about as many connections and weights between those connections in its brain as neurons in your brain. Maybe it just so happens that a neural network of sufficient size can handle a problem as complex as human language. I just hope that, after all of this, a video of sufficient size can help you understand a problem as complex as rapidly emerging AI technologies. Until next time. She found more plastic and then she threw up.
Now exiting the facility.
How do they find more plastic? Thank you so much to the very nerdy staff at the facility for the direct and substantial support in the creation of this here video. If you want to join the facility, if you want to drape on a silky white lab coat and stop my cat lady from eating all plastic on planet Earth, you can go to patreon.com/KyleHill to join the facility today. If you're on mobile, go into the description of this video, click the link, or if you're on desktop, just click join and you get private members only live streams. You get behind the scenes photos and videos and bloopy bloops. You get to talk to me on our private Discord, and if you support us just enough, you get your name on Aria here on each and every episode. As you can see, there's hundreds and hundreds of you. I haven't even figured out how. If you pressed me, the one thing I am still worried about with, I'm worried about a couple of things, but with large language models like this is once they start outputting more text than has ever been written by humans in history, will we get to a point where we don't actually know if anything we read, see, or hear is real? And at that point, it's going to be a dis- and misinformation apocalypse where we have to redound to some sort of established way of determining the veracity of stuff, and most of the human population is just going to tune out, and then we're going to have to rethink our media landscape, and it's going to, it could be bad. Thanks for watching. A chatbot wrote that.